What's up, guys? Welcome to another episode of Zed Chalila. Of course, we're on our Star of the Week segment. And guess who our star for this week is? Nah, I'm not gonna say it because I'm in loss of words. But of course, let's have a look at the song that is premiering exclusively on Zed Chalila. And when we come back, we'll chat more on the other side. Big ups.
As more and more people receive their COVID-19 vaccines, countries all around the world are lifting their quarantine restrictions. Celebrate with a special performance of Lost by El Mukuka and Adekunle Gold.
Sorry, I got no answers to your many questions, my love. My love. I didn't mean to hurt you. I wish you didn't know, my love. My love. If you let me go, let me go. I don't know what to do with my life. Oh, I know you want to get over me. Baby, please be easy on me. Oh, no. Hold me down, I'm falling. Without you, I am nothing. I'm lost. Oh, I'm lost. Without you, I'm nothing. Hold me down, I am falling. I'm lost. I'm lost. Me, reconsider me, baby. Oh, yeah. My love. If you want to shoot me now, lady, kill me softly, girl. Oh no. If you let me go now. I don't know what to do with my life. Oh no. I know you want to get over me, baby. I'm lost, oh, I'm lost. Without you, I'm nothing. Hold me down, I am falling. I'm lost, I'm lost.
I'm joined with the amazing El Mukuka. El Mukuka, welcome.
Hey man, what's up?
Thank good you. To have you on the
thank
show.
Thank you.
So we premiered your song Lost, and you know, I'm held up between thoughts because I'm looking at the lyrics that you use and the general idea behind the song. It's like you're trying to bring out a sense of motivation at the same time using strong lyrics behind to show something that's very sentimental and all that. What's like the idea there when you were playing with the words or the lyrics there?
Yeah, so it's quite interesting. The lyrics are a little heavier, a little more emotional, melancholic than the music. You know, obviously the song is about the feelings you have when you're longing for your loved one, when your loved one is no longer there. And that's how Adekunle Gold wrote the song and sent it to me. But I wanted to give some sort of hope to the listener. I wanted to have some light in the tunnel, down this emotionally dark tunnel, this lost tunnel. And I figured that giving the song an uplifting beat, uplifting music that is positive and full of summer vibes and party vibes would be a nice way to sort of have this interesting juxtaposition between melancholic lyrics and very happy music.
Wow. So before we even talk about like the feature, let's talk a bit more about the song itself.
Yeah.
Like, you know, sometimes when, because I heard you mentioned Adekunle God wrote the song and sent it to you.
Yeah.
But you as an artist, you know, you are in total control of how you want your sound to be presented to your listeners and your fans.
Yeah.
So in that case, like, do you ever get to have challenges in the sense that if you say, I want to work with this particular artist, and then this artist sends something that is totally different in your line of thought.
Yeah.
Do you ever get up in a position to say, "What? How would it feel like if maybe I don't welcome the idea?" Because by the end of the day, you're in charge of your content.
Yeah.
Do you ever find yourself in such a condition?
I mean, as the producer of a song, I'm the executive director of what the sonic aesthetics of the song is going to be. You know, like how the sound is going to come out. But at the same time, it's a collaboration, and I have to respect what my collaborators want as well. You know, there are certain projects I've worked on where my vision has been different from the vision of the singer, and the song ends up never coming out.
Yeah.
Or we just have a dispute that never gets resolved, or the entire direction changes because we have to come to a compromise. So yes, I always do have an idea, I have a vision, and with Lost, I had a vision, and thankfully Adekunle liked it. But even before I presented him my idea, I had like 6 different versions. So the process is always different also. Sometimes I'll be in the studio like this, you know, we'll sit down, maybe I'll sit at the piano or my computer and we start working on the song. Other times I will send the vocalist an instrumental. So the instrumental is there, the foundation is there. And then a few rare times, the vocalist will send me an a cappella, and Lost is one of those examples. Adekunle called me up one random morning and is like, "Bro," I think I was even in Italy at the time, like, "Bro, I have a song for us.
Wow.
Let me know what you think." And I had been pushing and hoping for this to happen for a long time. You know, I first met Adekunle Gold virtually about 3-4 years ago when I remixed his song Ire.
Oh.
And that's when the conversations around doing a collaboration started. So, you know, after creating like 4 or 5 different versions, reharmonizing the chord changes based on the vocals he sent me, I finally came up with what I thought was good, sent it to him, and he liked it.
Yeah.
But it's always different, the process.
Coming to mind, you know, I don't know if you're trying to avoid to talk about it, but
yeah.
It's something that made noise over social media.
Yeah.
You have a very big signing, like you pinned down a very big contract with Ultra signing.
Yeah.
How did that come about? Like,
man, it's it's even the song. A lot of people ask me, how did you work with Adekunle Gold? You know,
yeah.
I mean, how did this random collaboration happen between a West African, a big West African artist, and a Sub-Saharan African artist, or rather, you know, Southern African artist? It was a bit of a godsend. You know, I've been sending demos to Ultra Music for about 6 years.
Wow.
You know, and they just kept saying no, no, ignored, no, no,
yeah.
You're useless, no. And, you know, my stubbornness, my perseverance just kept at it. I kept sending, I kept trying to find my way into that record label. And eventually, 6 years later, they opened the door after I met with them in London last year.
Wow, amazing. That's great. And someone might help but wonder, you know, you're a Zambian artist. Do you like to refer to yourself as a Zambian artist? Because if my research tells me, well, your mom is Zambian?
My dad is Zambian. My mom is Greek.
Yeah, your dad is Zambian, your mom is Greek.
Yeah.
Do you ever feel, because by the end of the day, you know, even if you'd like to dispute it, but your sound is totally unique to the Zambian sound.
Yeah.
You know, it's something that even when you identify yourself with your music, it's more of the Western kind of sound. So do you ever find yourself in a situation where, like, let's say you're trying to present the music to a particular group of people that you want to inspire, at the same time you're trying to not have that dispute that it might not be a sound that is generally they're generally used to?
I don't know
if you understand.
So I mean, part of the question is incorrect. So my sound is not entirely Western. It's a fusion, just like I am.
Yeah.
I'm not white and neither am I black. I'm in between. I'm a zebra, you know. Is it white stripes on black or black stripes on white? So this is, my music is the exact same thing. You know, I take elements from African music and I take elements from Western music. And I think Lost, the reason I think this is my best song to date is because this fusion happens perfectly. You know, it's not easy to get this nice 50-50 balance of two cultures, because these cultures are very different, Western and African. But I feel like this song does it. So yes, there are many Zambians who think of me as a black sheep, as an outsider, which is very sad and ridiculous, because I was born and raised in this country. I'm proudly Zambian. I carry the Zambian flag everywhere I go, knocking down doors. But at the same time, I am who I am. I'm a mix. I'm a bit of a hybrid, in other words. You know, I have two cultures inside of me, and my life goal is to learn how to control and fuse these two cultures within the world of music. So some songs end up being maybe slightly more Western or slightly more African, but the general goal is to have this beautiful fusion for my two cultures to come together.
Amazing. So I don't want to hold you for a long time, but I just want you to just give me your thoughts on two things.
Yeah.
The first thing is that, you know, you've been exposed to high standard music and high standard production. What word of advice would you give out to the Zambian artists here? Like, okay guys, I think this will give you attention out there if you can work on A, B, C, and D. That's the first one.
Okay. Definitely perseverance is going to be one of the most important things, and a deep sense of passion, which is innate, you know, like you can't fake passion. It has to be your calling. And if it is your calling, then you have the raw materials. You know, a lot of people think that my beginnings were different from any Zambian musician's beginnings, and that's completely wrong. You know, at the age of 12, 13, I fell madly in love with rap music. So I used to use my mom's cassette, you know, recorder to like record intro parts of like Dr. Dre's beats on another blank tape. I just loop it, you know, like these 10-second loops. And then I had this silly microphone that I would plug into the, you know, the same system and just record my rap vocals. And then eventually a friend gave me FL Studio 3.4. You know, this was like, damn, this was, yeah. I was like 13, 14. So I started making rap beats, and then I formed a rap group at school, and I used to have shows at school. And as I started getting a bit older, I also started studying music theory and piano, because my mom insisted that I also had a formal music education and not just, you know, pursue this rap. I mean, I used to wear bandanas and do-rags and big pants. And then, thankfully, I guess, I continued evolving. Yeah. So I went to study music at my dream school back then, you know, it was the Berklee College of Music in Boston. Fortunately, I couldn't afford to finish, so I did half my degree and had to drop out because financial support wasn't enough. So I came back to Zambia. I was a sales agent selling a few things, random things, as I was working on my career. And in 2016, it took off and I was able to get into music full time. Now, all this time, I kept producing. I kept developing my production skills. I kept working on networking internationally. I would save up, take a flight to Europe and just network. Set up these blind meetings with record label executives. Many said no, some said yes. Every year, more and more people said yes. And I started to develop this network of my own. You know, there was never a silver spoon. It's like, hey, this is your network. This is your link into the music industry. I had to create the world that I live in, because Zambia didn't give me those materials, those opportunities, because the industry here is very small. It was even smaller a few years ago. And for someone doing electronic music, it was like, you know, it was taboo what I was doing. I was like, what is this? I remember playing a few shows. I would play 2-3 songs and they would already say, nah. This DJ sucks. Where was the previous DJ? Or when's the next DJ coming on? So, you know, the reason I'm saying all of this is just to let people know that it's possible. You know, we create our destiny. It's about the decisions we make every day when we get up. It's not about where we're born, the family we're born into, the opportunities we have or the opportunities we don't have. It's what we decide to do with what we have every day.
Amazing. Sounds like the first part, and here's the second.
Sorry, man, I got carried away.
No, actually, I think you've broken it down, and every person will get a few things to learn from. But here's the second thing. What's your vision? Because I'm sure when you sit back, you would love to see some industry somewhere in terms of music. Yeah. And you know, recently we've had record labels coming through, you know, building up artists that not so long ago didn't have hope for their music.
Yeah, yeah.
So when you sit back there, do you think you're capable of empowering, let's say, generally any form of music, or you would want your style of music to grow among the Zambian culture? What's your vision, let's say, in the next 3, 4, 5 years?
So yes, no, you've definitely tapped on something very important. Actually, two things: the music industry as an industry,
uh-huh.
and then music education,
uh-huh.
which is where it all starts. Uh-huh. You know, it's like trying to increase the number of doctors in the country, but not opening schools of medicine. Like, it's not possible, you know. Or sending a Zambian to space, but not having like an academy where they can train and prepare and study and do research. So yes, I want the electronic music industry to grow. I'm doing everything I can to help it grow, and I feel very happy when I see young musicians write to me, send me emails like, "Hey man, you know, check out my new song. I'm trying this new style, whatever it is. I feel like you can understand. I can relate." And it's really nice to see young Zambians producing electronic music. So as much as we have like an established group of Zambian DJ producers, we also have this upcoming generation, these teenagers for the most part, who are, you know, taking inspiration from us and from other people and doing even cooler things at their age. And then of course, like, my biggest vision though is to give back in terms of music education opportunities. Something I want to do 5-10 years from now is probably open a music academy where Zambians, you know, whether they have the financial abilities or not, can study there. So there'll be a few scholarship opportunities, and of course everyone else would pay to be there in order to keep the system running. But opportunities to study music at the highest possible level, you know, with the best teachers, with the best instruments available, with music technology present, you know, these are opportunities that we need. So many Zambians are talented, you know. We look at other African countries and we see them doing bigger things. South Africa, Nigeria, Kenya. And then we scratch our heads and think, what's wrong with Zambia? Well, nothing is wrong with Zambia in terms of lack of talent. What's wrong with Zambia is lack of opportunity. No one is developing and cultivating this talent. So how do we expect anyone to go as far as we want them to go, you know? There's a recent debate and everyone sharing their opinion on the Grammy Awards and when Zambia will receive its first Grammy Award.
Yeah.
Well, to be honest, Zambia will receive its first Grammy Award when the system starts to work and the system starts to empower its own people.
Mm-hmm.
You know, look at South Africa. They have a law that they can only play a certain amount of foreign music on radio. If I'm not mistaken, it's 80% local, 20% foreign.
Yeah.
So by default, they are empowering their own musicians.
Yeah.
And when you get played on radio, you're supposed to get paid.
Mm-hmm.
Let's not get into that topic here in Zambia, but in other countries where the system works, you do get paid.
Yeah.
So these incentives already trickle back into the industry and empower musicians. And until we fix our system, it'll be no Grammy. Yeah. Unless someone goes on their own, breaking down doors like Terminator and snatches that Grammy from the rest of the world.
Amazing. I actually thought this was going to be an interview, but it has been more of an education. I feel educated right now. Yeah, it's good to have you on Zecha Lila.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, so on Zecha Lila, we have a segment that is called The Rising Star of the Week.
Yeah.
You know, it's because we realize that in as much as we may not attract a lot of numbers, but there are a lot of people that are there watching our content.
Yeah.
So we say, why not empower a few upcoming artists?
Yeah.
And we have a lot of upcoming, even as I'm talking right now, a lot of them are watching this show. What would be your message to those people that have not yet been established, and then they just hope one day to say, okay, I might be like this one, or what do I have to do to reach at the level that Omokuka has reached?
Yeah. Okay, for you guys, I think I already said so much right now, so I'm not going to repeat myself. I'm going to keep this short. But the most important thing is perseverance, hard work, and a deep sense of passion for what you do. Life is going to knock you down many, many times. You just have to keep coming up. Just keep coming up. If this is what you really love, if this is what you believe in, just keep coming up. And I promise you that one day you'll come up for good.
Amazing. All right, guys, I have been joined by the amazing El Mokoka. So, how do you pronounce your first name?
Eleftherios.
Eleftherios.
Yeah.
Eleftherios.
Yeah.
I'm saying it right?
Yeah, perfect. So, the L literally comes from that, the first two letters.
El Mokoka, okay. Eleftherios.
Yeah.
All right. I mean, I hope next time we meet, I'm going to call you by the full name.
Yeah, why not, man?
All right, it has been good having you on the show.
Thank you.
Brother.
Thank you.
All right, guys. So, we're going to go on a break. And otherwise, from me and my team, it has been Zed Chalila. Boom.